The encoding technique used to transmit the signal in Giga Ethernet technology over fiber optic medium is, so in this signal is using the Giga Ethernet technology, okay. So in the Giga Ethernet technology, the encoding used to transmit the signal is 8B/10B encoding. So this encoding is used in the Giga Ethernet technology. What is this 8B/10B encoding? In this 8 bits of data can be represented as 10 bits in the signal. Okay, 10 bits data, and then it will be encoded into the signal. Okay, so this is called the 8B/10B encoding, and this encoding technique is used in this Ethernet technology, Giga Ethernet. Okay, so answer is D here. In this question, in compiler technology, reduction in strength means, so reduction means whenever we have some cost consuming operation and heavy operations, we can replace that those operations with the small cost operation. For example, if we have repeatedly multiplication, like this A equals to A into B and then B equals to B into C, then this multiplication operation, this is heavy operation or costly operation. So we can replace this multiplication operation with the plus or addition operator, repeated addition. So this repeated addition, this will make actually the multiplication. Okay, so this is called the strength reduction, and these techniques are used in the optimization, okay, code optimization. So what is this reduction in strength means? Replacing a costly operation by a relatively cheaper one. So this D is the right answer for this question. Okay, and in this the option A is replacing runtime computation by compile time computation. This is not strength reduction. Removing loop invariant computation, this is also not reduction in strength. And removing common sub expression, no, this is also not, this is called the constant folding, where constant is directly replaced with the expressions. Okay, so this is constant folding, this is not the strength reduction. So strength reduction is basically replacing a costly operation by a relatively cheaper one. This is the right answer, D. In this question, the following table shows the processes in the ready queue and time required for each process for completing its job. So these are the process and these are the time. So in this question, they are saying if we are using the round robin scheduling with 5 millisecond is used as a time quantum. So we know the time quantum here, which is 5 millisecond in the round robin algorithm. So we have to find what is the average waiting time of the process in the queue. Okay, so first we have given 5 process, P1, P2, P3, P4 and P5. Okay, these are the process, and what are the arrival time? This is given the arrival time. Why? Because in the table it shows the process in the ready queue and time required. Okay, no, so let's we have not given any arrival time here. So let's suppose all the process are coming at time 0, means all the process are coming at the same time in the system. Okay, and this time is the burst time means what is the CPU time required by each process. Okay, so thus 10, P1 is equals to 10, it means P1 requires 10 unit of CPU time, P2 requires 5 unit of CPU time, like this. Okay, so this is called the burst time BT. So burst time for P1 is 10, burst time for P2 is 5, burst time of P3 is 20, burst time of P4 is 8, and this P5 is 15. Okay, now we are using round robin scheduling algorithm. So what is the round robin scheduling algorithm? In this algorithm, all the process will have equal time share in the CPU. It means each process will assign to the CPU for the equal share of time, and this time is called the time quantum of the system or round robin algorithm. Okay, so this is time quantum is 5 milliseconds. It means each process will have will be assigned to the CPU for 5 milliseconds, and Okay, one by one each process will be assigned to the CPU. So first, since all these processes are coming at the same time of the system, so we can assign, so in the initial stage, in the beginning, there are 5 processes in the ready queue. We maintain here ready queue, which is in the circular, which is in the round robin algorithm, will be a circular ready queue. Okay, so this is P1, P2, P3, P4 and P5. All these process will be at time 0. At time 0, all these process will be in the circular queue. Okay, now we will remove one by one each process from here and schedule it to the CPU for the time quantum 5 milliseconds. Okay, so we can make Gantt chart here like this. From here, let's suppose this is Gantt chart. So at time 0, let's suppose I am assigning this process P1 to the CPU. So now P1 will be removed from this circular queue and it will be assigned to the CPU for 5 milliseconds for its time quantum. Okay, so for 5 milliseconds. Now since its total burst time or total requirement of this process P1 is 10 and we are executing this process till 5 milliseconds or its time quantum. Okay, so remaining time now is become 5 milliseconds, 10 minus 5, which is 5. Okay, now this P1 required again CPU time or burst time, because P1 is not completed yet. So I will add this P1 at the last, or at the last position, or at the end of this circular queue. So now P1 will be added here. Okay, now we will assign P2 here, and again P2 will be executed till its time quantum 5 milliseconds. Okay, so now P2 will be executed till 10 milliseconds. Now we can see that the total requirement or burst time of process P2 is 5 milliseconds and we have executed P2 till 5 milliseconds here. Okay, so P2 is completed now. So since P2 first removed from here and assigned to the CPU, now P2 is completed. So we need not to add this P2 again in the circular queue. Why? Because P2 is completed. So P2 is completed, so it will be out from the system. Now P3. For P3 again we will remove this P3 from the circular queue and assign to the CPU. Now P3 will again executing till its time quantum 5 milliseconds. So from 10 to 15 milliseconds P3 will be executed, and since the total requirement or burst time of the P3 is 20 milliseconds and we have executed P3 till 5 milliseconds. Okay, so the remaining burst time of P3 is 15, 20 minus 5, which is 15. Now P4 will be and since this P3 is not completed yet, so I will have to add this P3 at the last or at the ending of the circular queue. So P3 will be added now here. Now we'll remove P4 from here, assigned to the CPU and executing till its time quantum 5 milliseconds. Since 3 milliseconds left here because total burst time is 8, so now P4 is again added to the circular queue at the last, the ending of the circular queue. Okay, now P5 will be assigned to the CPU and total requirement of this is 15. So P5 will be here, and 15 means now burst time remaining 10, and P5 again will be added at the last in the circular queue, this way. Okay, now again P1 will be executing. Why? Because now we'll have to remove each process from the front end of the circular queue. So P1 will again remove. Now P1 will remove from here, assigned to the CPU, and again executing till its time quantum. So this is 20, this is 25 and this is 30. So P1 is again executing till its time quantum. So now remaining time of P1, which is burst time, it remains 0. It means P1 is completed now. So P1 will be out from the system at time 30 milliseconds. Okay, now burst time is 0. So P1 is out. Now P3 will be removed from circular queue, executing till its time quantum, so 30 to 35, and this is P3, yes. So at this point burst time of P3 is 50, but it is executed 5 milliseconds more So now the remaining burst time of this will be 10 milliseconds. Okay, so P3 will be here from 30 to 35. Now since P3 is not completed, so we will have to add P3 at the ending of the circular queue. Again P4 is coming, so we'll remove P4 from the circular queue, and time quantum of system is 5 milliseconds, but the remaining burst time, remaining requirement is only 3 milliseconds. So now P4 will be executed till 3 milliseconds and it will be completed after 3 milliseconds. So 35 to 38 P4 will be executed, and now P4 is completed. So we will not, don't need to add P4 again in the circular queue. Okay, so now P4 is completed. So only P5 and P3 is left. So now the chance of P5 is coming. So P5 will be assigned to the CPU and it will be again executed till 5 milliseconds or the time quantum of the system. So 43. Okay, so this is P5, which is 43. Now 43, okay. So P5, since total burst time of P5 is 10, we have executed till 5 milliseconds. So P5 will be again added at the ending of the circular queue. Now again P3 is coming. So P3, it will be executed till 5. So 48, burst time of P3 will be now 5. P3 is again added in the circular queue at the last. Now P5. So since burst time of P5 is 5 and time quantum is also 5, so now P5 will be completed after 5 milliseconds. So 53. Now here P5 is completed. Okay. So we don't need to add P5 again in the circular queue. P5 is completed. Only P3 is left, and requirement of P3 is now 5 milliseconds. So at time 58, all the process will be completed. Okay. And we can check that this Gantt chart is right or not. If we add these times, process P1, these burst time of all the process, then it will show the last time unit of the Gantt chart. Okay, so 10 plus 5 15 plus 20 35 plus 15, which is 50, and plus 8 58, and it is also shown by the Gantt chart. 58 is the last time unit. Okay, so now we have to calculate the average waiting time of the process. So what is actually the waiting time of the process? Waiting time means the turnaround time minus burst time of the process. What is this turnaround time? Turnaround time means completion time of process minus arrival time of the process. So at the time when one process is completed, if we subtract from this the arrival time of that process, it will turnaround time. It means the process will remain how much time unit for the process will be remained in the system. Okay, so this is turnaround time. And when this turnaround time, if we subtract the burst time of that process, it means this much time process need to wait in the system. So this is waiting time. So first we need to calculate the turnaround time. So turnaround time is completion time minus arrival time. So for process P1, completion time is this 30 and arrival time is 0. So 30 is the turnaround time for process. And again for process P2, completion time is 10 millisecond and arrival time is 0 millisecond. So it will be 10 minus 0, 10. For process P3, completion time is 58, arrival time is 0. So 58 minus 0, 58. For process P4, 38 minus 0, 38. And for process P5, the completion time is 53, arrival time is 0. So turnaround time is 53. So this is turnaround time. Now we want to calculate waiting time. So waiting time is turnaround time minus the burst time or the CPU requirement time. Okay. So since this 30 minus 10, 30 is turnaround time and 10 is burst time for P1. So waiting time will be 20. For here 10 minus 5, 5. Here 58 minus 20, which is 38. For here 38 minus 8, 30. and here the turnaround time is 53 and burst time is 15. So 53 minus 15, this is 8, and this is 3, again 38. Okay, so now these are the waiting time of each process. We have to calculate the average waiting time here. So average waiting time means we need to sum all these waiting time divided by the number of process. So this means 8 plus 8 16 and 21. Okay, so this is 1 2 4 7 10 13 131. So this is the sum 131, and this 131 will be divided by number of process 1 2 3 4 5. So this one, okay, so it will turn out as 26.2 milliseconds. So this will be the average waiting time of these process if we applying the round robin scheduling with time quantum 5 milliseconds. So answer will be 26.2 milliseconds here. So in this question, move, we have given the assembly language one instruction in the assembly language move, and this is bracket BX and AL. Okay, so what it shows is it register addressing mode. Okay, we have to find which type of data addressing is this called. Okay, so register addressing, no, it is not register addressing, because in the register addressing the operand will be directly fetched from the register, given register. But here it is saying this BX and then AL. Okay, and BX is in the capital bracket, it means we'll need to go at the location which is pointed by BX. And let's suppose in this BX register, if let's suppose 1000 is present, okay, so now we will have to go in the 1000 memory location 1000, and then need to fetch the data operand from this location. So this is basically the register indirect addressing mode. In the register, we will have one address. Okay, so we will have one address, like here in this register BX, we have address as 1000, and we need to fetch operand from this memory location 1000. So actual operand is present in the memory location 1000, which is stored in this register BX. Okay, and then from this 1000 location we have to move data from here to accumulator AL. Okay, so this is register indirect addressing mode. This is not immediate addressing. In the immediate addressing, the operand is directly present, or constant operand is directly present in the instruction itself. So this is not immediate, this is not register relative, this is also not the register relative. This is register indirect addressing mode. Okay, so answer will be this register indirect, C option. Evaluate X or Y. Okay, so basically we have this expression which is saying X or Y, and completely of this term XOR with Y. Okay, so we know that this XOR is the associative. It means if we do like this X or Y, or it is same as X or, then this Y or Y, because this XOR operation follows the associativity rule. Okay, so now since these two are same, so Y or Y, it will always become 0. Why it will always become 0? Whenever we let's suppose this is the XOR, we are making the truth table for XOR. So XOR, let's suppose this is XY and this is X or Y. So 0 0 0 1 1 0 and 1 1. So whenever two bits are different, then the XOR of those two bits will be set as 1. But whenever the two bits are same, then XOR will be always 0. So 0 and 0, XOR will be 0. 0 and 1, XOR of these two will be 1. 1 and 0, XOR of these two will be again 1. And 1 and 1, since these two bits, 1 and 1, both the bits are same, so XOR of these two bits will be 0. Okay, so similarly here y, x or y, it will always giving 0. Why? Because both the two bits are same. Now x, x or 0, this will be the operation x, x or 0. So whenever we do XOR with 0, okay, let's suppose we have X and this is 0, okay, X, the possible value of X will be 0 or 1 and this is 0, 0, okay. So if we do the X, XOR 0 here, so 0 XOR 0 means 0 and 1 XOR 0 means 1, okay. So it is actually same as X. This X, XOR 0 will be giving the same result as X, okay. So this complete expression will become now X. So answer will be, this statement will be evaluate to X. Okay. So this X will be the correct answer, option C. What is the decimal value of the floating point number C1D? Okay, this complete complete number is given in the hexadecimal notation, and we have to find the actual decimal value of this floating point number if we are using the IEEE representation, IEEE 754 representation. This is the representation. Okay, so first we need to understand what is this IEEE 754 representation. So in this representation there are three parts actually. If this number is present, so there will be three parts. The first bit of this, okay, so this will be always 32 bit representation, 32 bit binary number, okay. And now this 32 bit number in the question, it is given as the hexadecimal notation, okay. But basically this will be the 32 bit number. In this 32 bit number, the first part, the first bit is actually the sign bit. So one bit is for sign bit. Then after this first bit, the subsequent next 8 bits, it is for the exponent value. This is for exponent, this is for sign. And after this 8, the 23 bits, remaining 23 bits are for the mantissa. Okay. So sign, exponent and mantissa, these are the three parts in IEEE representation. Okay. And this is also always in the normalized form. So what is normalized, we can see here. Actually, if we want to convert this into the actual decimal floating point representation, then the expression will be like this: minus 1 to the power sign bit into 1.11 dot or 1 decimal mantissa, value of mantissa. This is called the normalized form. Why? Because before the decimal, this is decimal point, before this radix point or decimal point, always 1 will be occur here. This is called the normalized form. Okay. So 1 decimal mantissa into 2 to the power exponent minus 127. It is always fixed. Exponent minus 127. Why? Because this is the biased 127 form. This is biased 127 form means whenever we will put value of exponent, first we will increment by 127, we'll increment the exponent by 127 and then put that value into the exponent. Okay, so when we convert this into the decimal, we need to subtract 127 from the exponent value so that it will give the correct value. Okay, so this will be the expression: minus 1 to the power s into 1 dot mantissa into 2 to the power exponent value minus 127. Okay. So now we will arrange this. Since we have given C, and C, what is the value of C in decimal? Okay. Value of A, this is hexadecimal. In hexadecimal, A is 10, which is 1010. B is 11, which is 1011. C is 12, which is 1100. D is 13, 10, 11, 12, 13. 13 will be 1101 and E will be 14. Okay, so what is 14? 1110, 111 and then 0. And then F will be 1111. So since in the hexadecimal format, we have symbols from 0 till 15. Okay, so 0 to 9, these symbols are same as decimal, but after and starting from the 10, we'll represent 10 as A, 11 as B, 12 as C, 13 as D, 14 as E, and 15 as F. So this will be in the hexadecimal format. Now the given number is C. C means 12, so which is 1100. Each digit in the hexadecimal notation can be represented as 4-bit binary number. So this C will be 1100. Now this 1, since this 1 is hexadecimal, and if we need to convert this into binary, we need to put this 1 in the 4-bit binary number. So this 1 will be 0001. Now again D. So D is 13, which is 1101. So 1101. And then 0000 5 times 0. So these 5 times 0 means we'll need to put here 20 times, because each one digit in the hexadecimal should be represented as 4-bit binary number. So these 5 times 0, it will represented as 20 times 0 in the binary. So 0000, 0000, and then 0000, and so on. Okay, 32 bits. So these are the 32 bits of the given IEEE representation. Now if we need to convert this into decimal, so what is the expression here? Minus 1 to the power sign bit. And since sign bit is here 1, so minus 1 to the power 1, it means this number is the negative number. So minus 1 to the power 1 into, now what is the value of mantissa? Value of mantissa is 1 dot mantissa. So these 8 bits, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. This is exponent from here to 5, 6, 7, 8. From here to here, this is exponent. And after this is 1 actually, okay. And after this all will be the mantissa. So mantissa is basically 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, and so on, 23 bits of 0, okay. So 20 bit or 0, which is following the 101. And what is the exponent value? So value of exponent here is 1000011. Okay, so this bit, weight of this bit is 128. So 128, and then this is 3, so which is in, it is totally 131. Okay, you can convert this number into decimal by the traditional method also, but I am directly converted this 111, it is 131. So now 131, so it will 2 to the power 131 minus 127, which is 2 to the power 4. Okay, so this will given as minus 1 to the power 1. So I am directly put the negative number here, so minus sign, and then 1.101 dash dash, all the zeros are presenting here, into 2 to the power 4, which is 60. Okay, now we need to convert this 1 decimal 101 into the decimal format. This is binary format, we have to convert this into decimal. So how can we convert the radix point binary number into decimal? It is very easy actually. So this is 1, so we'll need to add this 1, plus now we have all the mantissa. So the weight of this will be 2 to the power minus 1, and this is 1, so 1 plus 1 into 2 to the power minus 1, which is 1/2, plus 0 into 2 to the power minus 2. So all the bits of weight of all the bits are like this. After the decimal, 2 to the power minus 1, weight of this bit will be 2 to the power minus 1, this will be 2 to the power minus 2, this will be 2 to the power minus 3, and so on, 2 to the power minus 4, minus 5, like this. Okay, so here this is 0 actually. Okay, this bit is 0, so 0 into 2 to the power minus 2 plus 1 into 2 to the power minus 3, and after this all the bits are 0 in the mantissa. So if all the bits are 0 after this, so 0 into 2 to the power minus 4 plus 0 into something, so this all will become 0. So only these 3 bits are useful here, so that's why I put only these 3 bits. So 1 plus 1/2, this will become 0, 0 into 2 to the power minus 2, 0, plus 1/8, 2 to the power 3. Okay, 2 to the power minus 3, it means 1 upon 2 to the power 3, which is 8. So this value will be directly what it what this give. This value will give actually, if we calculate this, 101. Okay, so this will be like 5 by 8. So 1 plus 5 by 8. Okay, so this will be 8 plus 5, which is 13 by 8. This is 13 by 8, and we need to multiply this number into 2 to the power 4, which is 16. Okay, so I am putting here minus 13 by 8. This is 13 by 8 into 16. Okay, this is 13 by 8. This value is 13. So 13 by 8 into 16, which is, we can cancel out here 8 and it will give 2. So final answer will be minus 26. This is the actual decimal representation of this floating point number. So answer will be option C here. This is minus 26.